Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the Matt Townsend Show. I'm your host, Dr. Matt Townsend, your coach, your guide on the side today, folks, honoring, remembering 9/11. September 11th. You know, it only comes around once a year. And everybody think about it. Think back. Do you have memories? Do you have thoughts? Do you remember where you were when you found out the news? The towers were falling. It's a big deal. And so on today's show, we wanted to go back and hear some of the stories, because everybody has a story of 9/11. We thought today might be a valuable use of the airwaves if we would just simply remember. Remember the wonderful, togetherness that we felt after, the country unified, and remember the stories, remember the people, remember that people died. And for a while, the U.S. was very united.
Oh, extreme. Remember that? Oh, yes.
And then?
One nation.
Uh-huh.
Really.
13 years later, the division again.
Yeah.
That's why I always sadly say we just need another national disaster. And we just come together.
But it's sad that that's what it takes.
Yeah. It really is. Because think of that. We were together. I was in.
Oh, yes.
Where were you?
On the actual
day of 9/11.
The day of 9/11. Actually, I watched the events happen on television in a newsroom.
Oh, yeah.
I was working at a news station on that day. I had worked the overnight shift, sitting in for somebody actually on the overnight shift. And then that morning.
You were about ready to leave.
I was, yeah.
And then. Mm-hmm. The news feed
was about an hour before
clicking.
I was leaving. Yeah. Oh, you know, the TVs. And if you have ever been in a newsroom,
oh, yeah.
You know how loud, you know how rambunctious things can
yeah.
be. People are running all over the place trying to meet deadlines. That place was still and quiet.
Oh, I can only imagine. I was in L.A. at the L.A. Marriott preparing to start a workshop, but which is where United Airlines held the grief counseling for the families on these planes. Because they were all heading to
They were going to Los Angeles.
So I was there for 3 days teaching a workshop, and across the hall from me, the grief counseling center for these families. So it was very, very vivid. So what we want to do today is get into some of the facts, some of the data behind it. And Sean has been doing some research. We're not going to call these headlines because these aren't headlines.
No, these are just facts.
But these are the facts that
about 9/11.
And if you lived through it, this should probably bring back some memories.
Yeah. Well, so we had 19 men get onto four different commercial airlines bound for West Coast destinations. That was on purpose.
Yeah.
Because they had lots of fuel.
From New York, I guess.
Yeah. Two went from Boston, one left from Dulles, and then the other left from Newark.
Newark, right.
So you have these 19 men getting on these four airlines, and they're all Al-Qaeda, Osama bin Laden, the leader there. And you have a total of 2,977 people killed in New York City, Washington, D.C., and in Shanksville, Pennsylvania, or outside of Shanksville, I should say. At the World Trade Center site in Lower Manhattan, 2,753 people are killed. And that's when American Airlines Flight 11 and United Airlines Flight 175 were intentionally crashed into the north and the south towers of the World Trade Center.
Which, by the way, that was the moment. So when you saw the plane.
Yes.
The first one, remember, there was already a plane. They couldn't see. They couldn't tell.
Yeah, there were people saying, well, I don't know what it was. I saw an object go into it. And I remember that's when the breaking news started. You could already see smoke coming out of the first tower that was hit.
I remember turning on. My wife said, "Turn on the Today Show." I turned on the Today Show. I was ironing clothes.
Yeah,
and then that second plane hit.
Your wife was with you in Los Angeles?
No, she called me in.
She called it in. Okay.
Yeah, and then the second plane hit, and then it's like, oh boy.
Yeah. Once we saw the second plane hit, everything changed.
Yeah.
That moment. Well, you know, at
first, the world changed.
Yeah. the first plane hitting, you think, well, that could have been just, you know, that could have been a plane malfunctioning.
Right.
Could have been anything, you know.
A civilian. I mean, just somebody.
Exactly. And we didn't know if it was a commercial. We didn't know what kind of plane it might have been. Could have been a helicopter or something. Who knows? Although it was a very big hole.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. But the first plane hit at 8:46 Eastern time. That was America Airlines Flight 11 going from Boston to Los Angeles. And that hit the North Tower. Then at 9:03, so less, just almost 20 minutes later, United Airlines Flight 175, also from Boston to Los Angeles, hits the South Tower of the World Trade Center.
Wow.
That's when our world really changed.
That's it. Do you remember? And that's just when.
That's when we knew it was an attack.
Yeah, and I remember people saying, "Gosh, this is the end of the world."
Some people did. Yes,
this is our Pearl Harbor.
Yes, I would agree with that.
James, what were you doing? You must have been two.
I was in elementary school.
Were you?
Yeah,
do
I was
you remember?
In sixth grade. I do.
Oh, sixth grade. You were old enough.
Yeah. So, I mean, I was still young enough that, like, I guess I didn't understand the full implications of what was happening, you know. But, I mean, I definitely realized at the moment the second plane hit that, you know, that scary realization that America was under attack.
Yeah.
But yeah, I just had gotten to elementary school that morning. I hadn't heard any of it because I walked to school, and so I walked into the classroom, and our teacher already had a television that was turned on. And
oh, really?
We had a television in the classroom, and we actually didn't do anything that entire day. We just kept on the television on the news and just watched it. And I guess we were all just kind of in shock, you know, that this was happening.
Mm-hmm. Did they cancel schools the next day? I was out of town.
I don't believe they did. I don't think they did.
They just kept going to school.
Yeah.
Kept watching it on TV.
My kids were not in school, so
yeah,
at that time.
I was a leader of a congregation in the LDS church. I was a bishop, a lay leader. And 200-300 people needed someone to talk to. So when I got back from LA.
Which took a few days.
Yeah, I took a bus back.
Oh, did you?
Yeah. And by the way, got a lot of different people were on those buses.
Oh, yes.
So I got on the bus.
Crowded, too, I'll bet.
Very crowded. And I got to take a Greyhound from basically L.A. to Salt Lake City, which means you stop every hour.
Yeah. It's probably a 20-hour trip.
Yeah. And the guy would, like, you know, what would he say? Mesquite, Nevada. Mm-hmm. 10 minutes. Smoke them if you got them. And everyone would get off, go smoke, and then I'll get back on. But in Vegas, I'm sitting there, and there was like one or two empty seats. No, there was an empty seat next to me, and there weren't very many on the bus. And you know when people get on the bus, and you're like, oh, no, don't sit by me. Mm-hmm. I don't want you to sit by me. Well, I don't know how to say, just this.
Dancer?
Just an exotic dancer.
That's the best way to put it.
Named Mocha. That was her stage name. She got on the bus, and I'm like, oh, boy. Oh, boy. And Mocha came and sat right next to me.
All right.
And so the rest of the night, it went all the way through the night, Mocha and I just talked.
Cool.
I go, what's your name? She's like, Mocha or Honey. They call me both. And I'm like, really? She goes, what do they call you? And I'm like, Bishop.
Matt.
Bishop. They call me Bishop. That's what they call me. Anyway, my 9/11 was that.
Yeah.
Crazy.
Well, 9:37 on that day, it was when the American Airlines Flight 77, which was the one from Dulles to Los Angeles, hit the Pentagon building. At the Pentagon, there were 184 people that were killed there. And then in Shanksville, Pennsylvania, he had 40 passengers and crew members aboard United Airlines Flight 93, who died when the plane crashed into a field. Of course, we all know about the passengers trying to retake the plane.
That's right.
Although, I don't know if we will ever know whatever would actually happen on that plane. I don't know if they were actually trying to retake it or if they were trying to just...
Yeah, they were.
...take out the people that were there. But it was an amazing day. And then at 9:59 that day, the South Tower collapsed, and at 10:03 was when Flight 93 went down, and then at 10:28, the North Tower collapsed.
Meanwhile, President Bush circling the country.
President Bush was in a classroom, a second grade classroom.
When it was told to him.
When it was, yeah. I've been watching a lot of video, actually, in preparation for this.
Then they got him in the air, circled.
And he stayed there.
And then...
they refueled in the air.
Yeah, airport shut down. I remember looking out at LAX airport. Not an airplane.
There was not an airplane
moving
in the sky.
And there wasn't any moving on the ground.
Right. The only one in the sky was probably the president and any other military escort that he had.
But the buses were moving.
They were.
Isn't that amazing? That was honestly, the safest day of our lives.
Well, planes were down for 3 days.
Yeah. I mean, think of that. It was the scariest day. But we were in more danger on September 10th.
Yes.
Than we were on September 11th. Once September 11th hit, yeah, or 12th, because then it's over, you know, now it's just game on. So today we got a great show, because here's what we're going to do. We talked about the airplane that hit, that first one that hit the tower, which was Flight 11 that hit the World Trade Center. We have a guest joining us now who had family on that airplane. And a little bit later in the show, the airplane that hit the Pentagon, we're going to be talking to one of our wonderful military members who was in the Pentagon the day that plane hit. We're hearing the stories, folks. The stories from 9/11. Those that lost friends, close loved ones from the inside. We're going to be talking about 9/11. We're taking a break. When we come back, honoring the memories, honoring the lives of those that were lost on 9/11. This is the Matt Townsend Show right here on BYU Radio. Welcome back, friends, to the Matt Townsend Show. Today, we are celebrating the memories, the lives of those that we lost on 9/11. 13 years ago, think about it, every one of you has a story. You remember where you found out about it. You remember the stories that you heard on the news, all of those wonderful vignettes that you saw. People were changed on September 11th. Today, we specifically wanted to get into a few of the stories that we have heard that maybe you haven't heard. Family members who had loved ones on those airplanes or loved ones at the Pentagon. And today, we're going to be hearing their story. Right now, I have in studio with me Margret Wahlstrom. Margret, been married to Norman Wahlstrom for 40 years. She has 7 children, 18 grandchildren. Attended Utah State University, Weber State University, and she also currently is a member of the board of directors for Utah's First Lady Jeanette Herbert's initiative on families called Uplift Families. But the reason we wanted Margret on the show today is Margaret's mother-in-law, Mary Alice Wahlstrom, and her sister-in-law, Carolyn Ann, is it Buke?
Yes. That's right.
Were both killed on September 11th aboard Flight 11 at the World Trade Center. So that was the first airplane that hit. That had your mother-in-law and your sister-in-law.
Yes, it did. And what a moment in our life. It changed everything forever.
Oh, yeah. How could it not, huh?
But, yeah, that morning, it was beautiful. It was such a beautiful day.
Yeah, do you remember? I remember.
So, oh, yes, it's vivid in my mind. We had a daughter that morning that was supposed to be leaving for Germany to go on a mission for our church. And we were all excited to go to the airport and see her off to Germany. It was picture day for my youngest daughter, Mallory.
School pictures, huh?
School picture day. And so normally I would have been in the kitchen cleaning up from breakfast watching the news. But I wasn't that particular morning because I was doing her hair.
Got to get her hair ready.
And she, you know, you put the TV in front of her so she sits still. But I was fixing her hair. She was 12 in junior high. And I was fixing her hair and the phone rang. And I went and answered it. And it was one of my daughter Marianne's friends that was supposed to go to the airport with us. And she said, "Is Marianne still flying out today?"
Oh, boy.
And I thought it was a strange question. And I said, "Oh, yeah, of course."
Yeah, today's
the day. And
she said,
"Well, haven't you heard?" And I said, "No, what heard what?" And she said, "Well, a plane just went into the World Trade Center and someone has bombed the Pentagon." And that was the information she had. And, of course, I'm in shock and yeah. trying to wrap my brain around the whole thing. And she says, well, go turn on the television. So I did. And as I'm watching, like every other American, with horrific shock and unbelief, the phone rang again. And it was my brother-in-law, Philip, from Las Vegas.
Oh, boy.
And his voice was horrible. I could tell he was upset. And I said, Philip, what do you need? He says, I need to talk to Norm right now. And I said, well, he's on his way to work. And he says, well, I've got to talk to him. And I said, what's the matter? And he says, well, I think Mom and Carolyn are on that plane.
Oh, and did your heart just sink? What do you do right there?
Well, you immediately try to figure out all the reasons why it can't be true.
Yeah, it can't be that. Yeah.
Because we were supposed to be picking her up that day from the airport after we sent my daughter off. You know, I'm thinking, well, wait a minute. She's not in New York. She's in Boston.
Yeah.
So it can't
it
be
It can't
her.
Be a, Bo- a New York it plane. It's her. A Boston plane.
And, of course, Mallory's listening to this. And so I got off the phone after I talked to Philip. I told him how to get hold of Norm. And I thought, I've got to get Mallory out of here in case this is real.
Yeah.
I just wanted her out of there. So I took her to school.
Yep. Time to go to school.
And
you look great.
So
let's get your picture
taken. I took
taken.
Her to school. But she knew. She kind of knew all day that something was wrong. And I had this big image in my mind as things unfolded that day that I was going to have this quiet moment in the evening, which never happened.
Yeah, no.
To talk to the kids. But anyway, we had another daughter in high school at the time that had a tennis tournament that day in Ogden, and we were supposed to be going to that after we went to the airport. And she called from school and asked if we had seen what was going on. And mm-hmm. I said, oh, yeah, you know, and I really did a good job, and I did not let on to her that anything was wrong. And so she went about her day at school not having any clue at all. And the sad thing about that part of the story is Meredith, my little high school girl, she was a sophomore at the time, went to her tennis match, which we never missed them, but we missed that day. And she heard the story coming home in the car with her friends. That her grandmother had been killed, and she heard it on the radio. I mean, that's how she found out.
Because the news found out her name and found out, is that how she knew?
Yeah, and I was surprised at how fast the news found out.
Did they find out before you? Did you get an official call?
No.
Or did the family get a call that said somebody, your mother, and nobody got a call?
No, we spent about 45 minutes to an hour trying to get hold of somebody who could tell us whether or not they were on that plane. And it took, you know, everybody was calling American Airlines and everybody was on the phone. And it took us a long time to actually verify that they really were on that plane and that it was true. And so I was shocked, though, at how fast the news media got on top of it, because I got home. And within 2 hours of the whole thing happening, our house was surrounded by cameras and news media and people calling on the phone. And it was unbelievable.
Well, and your husband lost his mom.
Yes, he did. And he came immediately home to be with his father. His father was in tremendous shock. And that was a very sad thing to watch. I'll never forget the moment that my husband put down the phone when he realized that his mom and sister were on that plane. And he said, this is just so cruel. Mm. And, you know, it was just that. But what was amazing, I had a son at the time that was in Nauvoo doing BYU.
Yeah.
Study abroad in Nauvoo.
Nauvoo, Illinois.
He was in Nauvoo, Illinois. We couldn't get him home. We had our daughter that was supposed to go to Germany that day. They allowed her to come home from the MTC in Provo with her companion, and she arrived home within a few hours. I had a couple sons that were at BYU as students, my daughter that was in high school, my daughter that was in junior high, but everybody came home.
Yeah, everyone came home.
Everybody came home, and I've often thought about that and how it's kind of like encircling the wagons.
Yeah, yeah.
When you have a family unit like that, that love each other so much and that support each other, I think that that is one of the core principles of survival.
Yeah. Yeah.
It really is.
Making it through such a thing.
Yeah.
You need your family to come home. People, you need to be surrounded, taken care of.
Well, and you give each other strength. And I was quite surprised that day at just how strong my children were. They were amazing. They totally amazed me.
So you had you had grandpa, you and your husband, and then your kids. And the kids brought a lot of strength.
Oh, they were amazing. In fact, the news people kept coming to the door and knocking on our door. And my husband said, I absolutely cannot talk to anybody. I just can't do it.
Right.
And so some of the kids finally went out and started talking to him. And to listen to my children speak was an amazing thing. And then they kept saying, well, we want one of the adults to come out. And so at one point I finally went out and spoke to them. And you know, that was a moment of truth for me, because I'd always thought that if I had someone in my family that was killed or, you know, had something horrible happen to him, that God would forgive us if we didn't like him, if we hated him a little bit.
Right.
Yeah, we
got
angry. And I had known people that had horrible things happen in their lives, and I'd been close to a couple people who actually had family members murdered, and I thought,
yeah, I get that. Yeah, you could get that.
But when that reporter put that microphone in my face and said, do you want revenge? How do you feel about this? And in that split second, I realized that I could not hate them, that I couldn't want revenge. Because of the principles we held as a family.
Beautiful. You stuck to your principles when hate would have been easier.
Yeah.
Well, but in the end, it would have gotten you.
Yeah.
We're talking with Margret Wahlstrom, remembering those that we lost on 9/11. We're going into the other side of the story, the side of the story you don't always hear, the family, those that are left behind. We want to hear about them. We want to hear from them today. We're going to take a break. When we come back, more from Margret Wahlstrom and her story of her loss of her mother-in-law and her sister-in-law on 9/11 aboard Flight 11 at the World Trade Center. This is the Matt Townsend Show. You're listening to us right here on BYU Radio. Welcome back, friends, to the Matt Townsend Show. Today, honoring the lives of those we lost on 9/11 and the lessons we've learned. We're trying to figure out and see if we can't bring back to life some of that spirit that we had as a country, that unified hope. We were together as a country, and we wanted to make sure on this day that we see if we can't rekindle some of that. Joining us in studio today is Margret Wahlstrom. Now, Margret, her husband is Norman Wahlstrom, and Norman's mother, so Margaret's mother-in-law, and Norman's sister.
You know, we don't do in-laws in our family.
Yeah, no, you're all just family.
That's it.
Well, why would you? Yeah, it's not. I mean, if there was a lawsuit, you'd need the in-law.
I know,
but there's no lawsuits here. But her name, your sister-in-law, was Carolyn Ann
Bugue.
She died in that plane crash along with her mother, and you had to deal with 9/11, but you had to deal with it. And the loss of a family member, two family members, and the media wanting to hear your story, and the mourning that had to you had to mourn. You had to go through. Tell us, and you mentioned a little bit earlier about how your values, your family, you know, values, your religious beliefs. How did that help you kind of go through that process? How did your family help you heal as a family?
Well, you think about grief and pain, and there's absolutely no way to describe that to anybody that hasn't experienced it, and we all experience it differently. But you think about how do you deal with grief, or how do you deal with that kind of pain? There's no aspirin for it. There's no magic for it. But we found a really important element, and that was, first of all, gratitude.
Yeah.
you know, you asked me a minute ago about reliving 9/11 every year.
Because it's every year it's coming up. And is that a good thing? Is that a bad thing for you?
It's a good thing. Because for us, it's a day of gratitude. It is a day of gratitude. And we kind of ended up wrapping our grief, which you feel and you go through and you continue to go through it forever. But we kind of wrap it inside of gratitude and purpose. And, you know, I think our value system and our faith gives us purpose in life. And if you have purpose and you have hope, and that's all encompassed in faith, and you have those things, then you can make that step forward.
Yeah.
And I've always hated the term closure or moving on, because that connotates that you've closed a door or you've left something behind and you're moving on without it. No, you move on with it. But I prefer to think of it as moving forward with purpose. And
so
with
you had to find a new purpose. I mean, you lost people you love. And that's hard, but you then went forward with faith, really. You went forward with hope, and you wrapped that loss into a new purpose.
Exactly.
What was
the
purpose?
Some of the old purpose of family, but new purpose in meaning.
It was much more meaningful.
The same old things we've always loved. You know, you love your family. You love what you're trying to do in life and your goals that you've set for your family. But now suddenly you realize how fragile life is, how things can happen beyond your control, how there's bad people in the world out there, and how are we going to stop that? How are we going to stop hate? Well, you counteract it with love, and you counteract it with aggressive service and living your life to the fullest as far as your value system will allow you to.
So you wanted to live fully. And so instead of using the energy to maybe drive more anger, more hate, more vengeance, you turned it to love. And then you wanted to just leave it all out there.
Yeah, and give back all the time. And I love how my children have grabbed up the torch. And my husband actually did get to run the torch
in the Olympics
that year. But, you know, you take that torch and you hold it up high and you go forward and try to help others. And that was an overwhelming desire for us, because right after 9/11, we got letters from literally all over the world.
Did you really?
Because of our membership in the LDS Church, they had done an article in the Church News and in the Ensign about us. And so people all over the world had heard about our family. And suddenly I started getting letters from literally all over the world.
Oh, wow.
Full of love. People we'd never met. And when people give you that kind of love, you want to give it back.
Isn't that amazing? Because you become the highlight of it all. Everyone goes to you. And yet you're being fed by just somebody that read an article and thinks, I want to thank her. And they write you a letter. And then that lifts you up.
Well,
and
it made me want to be even better than I was. That's I've got to live up to this.
That's how you change the world then.
Yeah.
I mean, you could just hate, or you just give and love. And isn't that interesting how everybody was lifting everybody?
Yes.
You did your job, going through the grief, and I guess the reporters did their job writing an article, which you allowed information on, more information probably than you wanted to, and which they stole and ripped from you. And then somebody reads it and is changed and feels a prompting to write you, which lifts you. I mean, there's power if all of us would just do what we're prompted to do.
And the word unity.
Yeah.
The word unity. You know, we built the memorial in Kaysville.
Now tell about this, because I haven't mentioned it yet. You last year, you basically you put together a memorial in Kaysville, Utah, of a fireman on a knee, bronzed, 9 feet tall, looking to God, I guess, and holding a
looking
baby.
Looking upward. Think about looking up.
Yeah.
Not looking down.
Yeah.
Looking up.
Hope.
The fireman represents the first responders, of course, from the World Trade Center and 9/11 and the whole day. The first responders were everywhere that day, Pentagon, everywhere. But he also represents us as first responders.
Yeah.
This is what our Youth of Promise or our kids came up with. He represents us, and he's holding a child. And the reason he's holding a child is that is our future. The child represents our future, our hope for the future. And he's looking up because that's kind of where you look when you're going through those kind of things. And so the kids, this was really important to them. And he's got his hat off in reverence here on the ground.
He's on one knee.
On one knee. As if, you know, we think about how 9/11 brought us to our knees.
Yeah.
It brought us to our knees in a different way.
Yeah.
Not like some people would think, but it brought us to our knees in unity and in faith. And we all had faith of some kind that day.
Oh, absolutely.
In something better and something greater.
Even just a future.
Into
that would
future.
Be brighter.
But the three words the kids came up with to represent our memorial were remembrance, hope, and let's see, I got to think, hope, unity, and remembrance.
Wow.
So those were the three words.
And it came from your kids.
It came from the Youth of Promise, which are 14 to 18-year-olds.
That's amazing.
They were awesome to work
with. That's what you said earlier, is how much the children that didn't quite get it, meant and how much they drove your healing too.
Well, and one of the original girls, her name's Camille, and she was just 14, 15 when we first started this memorial. And her whole thing, she said, someday I want to bring my children here and show them this memorial and tell them about it and tell them my part in building it and what it means to me and hopefully teach them how to be better people and to make a better world.
That's amazing. Again, I guess, as an outsider that thinks, could I go through that? What would you say to somebody that's thinking, I don't think I could go through that?
Well, you have to.
I mean,
When you're faced with it, you have to. And so you rely upon your resources. And just like we're told sometimes to, you know, I know now with the disasters that you hear about, the hurricanes, the different things people are all into thinking about, storing food and preparing for disasters. You have to prepare for your emotional disasters too and your pain because they'll come. And you prepare for them by building up your value system, your hope, and your purpose of life.
If you haven't been working on your purpose, if you don't know it, that's where it'll be exposed.
Exactly. It's where you find out the most about yourself.
Yeah.
And you know, strength isn't something you have. It is something you become.
Yeah.
It's not something you are. It's something you become.
And maybe many of us don't even have an idea of how strong we really are.
And I think we're all stronger than we realize.
Oh, yeah. And then all of a sudden you have a crazy disaster that makes you play the hand.
Yes, exactly.
That's beautiful. Well, Margret, we appreciate you and we honor you and your family and just your incredible spirit to want to make it better. We so appreciate you.
Thank you for having me here.
Tell your family we love them and thanks for the hope, the unity, and the remembrance. Those are the words, right?
Exactly.
Those are going to go down in
thank
history.
You.
We're going to use those a lot today.
Okay.
Again, Margret, thank you. And a story. Right. But a story of strength, a story of power, a story of healing. And honestly, folks, as Americans, we need to remember these stories. It's not enough to just remember 9/11. We could just talk terrorism all day long. We need to talk about what Margaret's talking about. Hope, unity, remembrance, our values, our family. Those are the places where true healing take place. We're going to take a break, folks. We'll be right back. More honoring those on 9/11 that we've lost. More lessons to be learned right here on the Matt Townsend Show on BYU Radio. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the Matt Townsend Show. I am your host, your guide on the side. Today, we are talking about 9/11. Lessons learned, the spirit felt, and the lives that were lost. And we're trying to basically give you some other stories, some stories you probably haven't heard. Every one of us, this is what I think is really powerful about 9/11. Every one of us has a story of what, you know, we went through, what we felt, what we did as you know, you found out about the planes crashing into the buildings Also, we've been bringing on people who lost family. Margret Wahlstrom was here. She lost her mother-in-law, Mary Alice Wahlstrom, and her sister-in-law, Carolyn Ann Bug, who were both killed on aboard Flight 11. That was the first airplane to crash into the World Trade Center. A little bit later, we're going to be bringing in Ken Page, who was a colonel and was in the military serving at the Pentagon. And he himself was there the day the plane hit, and by truly a blessing from above, was not, you know, in harm's way at the time of that plane hitting the Pentagon. So we're going to be bringing Ken on in a minute. But before we do this, Sean's been doing some research on children. And because, again, before the break, I was telling you, this is a great time to teach not just the tragedy, the horrors of what happened on 9/11, and a lot of the news stories. If you remember, we were traumatized, and we kept watching stories after story. Do you remember for a month? It was just nonstop every night.
Mm-hmm.
But Sean has been putting together some learning, some ways that we might want to share the lessons of 9/11 and help our children.
Well, so 3 years ago, we had the 10th anniversary.
Yeah.
And I remember my kids came home from school that day asking about 9/11. And I sat there and thought, well, my oldest was there watching the TV with me when it happened.
Yeah.
Well, and then I realized she was two.
She really wasn't watching.
She was just about to turn three.
Yeah.
So it was, you know, it was very different.
Yeah.
My second child was not even a year old at that time.
Yeah.
So, and my two other children weren't even born.
But these young kids, they can't necessarily handle it.
No,
they don't. There's not a context. There's not a
exactly.
They don't get it. So we got to do more than just put them in front of the TV.
Well, now what I'm thinking of though is I'm betting that my kids are going to come home from school today and say, "Hey, do you realize today's 9/11 Patriots Day?"
Yeah,
and I'm going to say, "Yes, I do. Do you realize why we have a commemoration of this day?"
Well, and think of how raw this is that you remember, right?
Yeah, so I remember.
Fast forward 80 more years.
I know.
You probably won't remember by then.
Maybe not.
So, let's keep it alive.
But how do you answer your kids' questions? How do you talk to your kids about this whole situation about 9/11? And I was looking out at the 911memorial.org website, and they have an article on how to do it.
Excellent.
And I think it's a very good article.
Well, give us the tips.
The first step they talk about is to not avoid a difficult conversation.
Yeah, don't run. Don't run from it.
Remember that the attacks themselves are the thing that's upsetting, not the conversation about them.
Yeah.
Talking about them is not necessarily going to upset your child.
Right.
Now, if you put them in front of a TV and show them all the video.
Yeah, and then ignore them.
Exactly. That could be. But you can also ask, what do you think we are remembering on the anniversary of 9/11? Or what would you like to know about 9/11? Let them figure out what to ask you.
Yeah, let them lead it.
If
you go asking all the questions, you're not paying attention to them. They're going to give you – you'll know. I mean, if they'll know when they're more interested, they'll give you more questions. Mm-hmm. When they're not, they might back out.
And then answer the questions about the attacks with facts.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because your children have all these, you know, all these information sources coming at them with all sorts of different information about the attacks.
That's right.
But
and facts and because we've also we've politicized it. We've done all of these things that it seems like we might do more harm if we tell a horribly biased, non-factually based approach to this. You might set your kids up to hate a culture.
Exactly.
You could set them up to hate Islam and not even understand.
And that's not what we want.
That's not what we need, right? Mm-hmm.
The third step is to acknowledge that we don't have all the answers.
Yep.
You know, you may not be – they may bring up a question that you don't know the answer to about this event.
That's right.
It's very possible. But it's okay to say, you know, I'm not sure about that. Or I don't know
that's
that answer.
That's a great question. Let's go find it out.
Exactly. I'm sure there's tons of information on the internet that you could do. You could search out. The next one is to be specific.
Yeah.
Don't paint over it in broad strokes. Yeah. Oh, yes, a lot of people died that day.
Yes.
That's why we're remembering this day.
Yeah. Yeah. Talk about the planes. Talk about the locations.
Right.
Talk about what happened.
And remember that your child's emotions are going to vary in this this whole situation. They're going to be – they may run the gambit from, you know, total breakdown crying because a lot of people died to maybe being a little just, oh, really?
Yeah. What?
Yeah.
Huh? Yeah. So take their lead.
That's exactly right.
That's huge.
Listen to them, and that's why you have them ask the questions.
Yeah.
Now, you want to monitor your TV and internet sources because
today's going to go crazy.
It is.
Except there is a BYU football game on.
Yeah, well, today's going to go crazy, yes.
So you might want to watch that as well.
Right. And then know yourself. Remember the emotions that you had when you thought about this.
That's the power of it, because then you can connect real emotion to it.
Mm-hmm.
Real power. One of the things I remember vividly, and it involves children. So I was at the time, it was actually 2 years later or a year later. I was a scout leader.
Okay.
So I went from being a leader of a group in my church of hundreds of people. Then I was in charge of scouting.
Sorry.
Which is great. It was great. It was a lot easier and more – it was interesting. But I was in charge once of putting together a flag retiring ceremony where you retire a flag. And it's an interesting ceremony, and it's very precise how you do it, because so we had this tattered flag from our church. It needed to be retired, and there's a protocol, and you follow the protocol.
Exactly.
And as part of the protocol, you end up ceremoniously cutting the flag up, and you'll cut things out, the stars out, and then you burn them, and you say certain things. So we decided we were going to do this, and we invited the fire department to show up.
Sure.
They managed the fire, so we didn't burn a bunch of scouts. And we were celebrating our military. We were celebrating the firefighters, all the volunteers, and in remembrance of 9/11. And it was the most incredibly solemn moment I have ever seen.
Wow.
In probably ever in scouting, but ever in probably my life.
Hmm.
Was in a parking lot of a church, fire department crying, police department there, and a bunch of scouts, just misfit scouts that felt something.
That's great.
So I sit there and I think, we think of these kids as like, they're just a bunch of sponges.
Right.
But they are. They're also, they
sometimes
get it.
Sponges leak.
They do. They do. They did. And but they also get the power of this. So don't overlook the kids. This is their memory. This is their history. This is their future.
Exactly.
If we can tie them into learning this and then elevate them by remembering the hope of it.
That's the last step. Emphasize hope.
This isn't just dark.
No.
As we've heard already.
Yeah.
And we also need to make sure we're thanking those that gave their lives and the military as well.
Exactly.
This should connect us to that, and also loving all mankind.
Now, I remember doing this 3 years ago on the 10th anniversary. Nickelodeon actually put out a news special about 9/11.
Perfect. For kids.
If you remember the news person, Linda Ellerbe.
Yeah.
She's the host of this. And you can search Nick News 9/11, you will find it. I found it today myself. It's about 25 minutes long.
Wow.
That's
something to watch.
It is. If you want to sit down with your kids and be able to have them ask you questions about 9/11, this is the thing to watch.
I'm telling
you. Linda Ellerbe goes through and answers.
Yeah.
She says, here's the facts. Here's what happened that day. And then they have kids ask questions.
Yeah. Which your kids would relate to. And
exactly.
It's Nickelodeon.
Exactly.
So your kids are already trusted.
Exactly. It's a very, very good
it's a great resource.
Way to show your kids what happened on this day.
Man, it's a powerful stewardship you have when you have a child and an important event like 9/11. We're going to take a break, folks. When we come back, we've got a true hero, I believe. Retired Colonel Kenneth M. Page is joining us. He was in the Pentagon. And by grace was protected and saved and was not harmed, but got to see the aftermath of it. We're going to invite him in to tell us his story. Colonel Ken Page after this break right here on the Matt Townsend Show. Welcome back, everybody, to the Matt Townsend Show. Today we are honoring all those involved in 9/11, those that lost their lives, those that saved people's lives, those that had to go through the battle of maybe being in the Pentagon and having to sort through, you know, and see how blessed you were that you weren't taken in that tragic event. And so we've asked a very special guest to join us. His name is Kenneth M. Page. He is retired, served as a colonel in the United States Air Force, and he served there for 25 years. He was a helicopter pilot, a wing commander at Hill Air Force Base, which is here in Utah, a group commander of the Air Force Survival School near Spokane, Washington. He was also a squadron commander of the 1st Helicopter Squadron near Washington. And he also worked in D.C. as a defense contractor in the Pentagon after retiring from the Air Force. He's married to his beautiful wife, Joni, who is here. And I think we're going to bring her in a minute. She's his personal bodyguard and won't let him go now. They've been married 37 years. They have 5 children, 13 grandchildren. Kenneth, thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me.
And first of all, too, thank you for your service, 25 years.
I appreciate it.
And you were in the Pentagon the day, the fateful day, 9/11.
Yeah, I was. But first, if I may, yeah. I'd just like to extend my condolences to the families of all of those who passed away on that day and a salute to all the heroes.
It's true.
Because there were a lot of them that day.
There were a lot of them. And I bet you saw a lot of them in the Pentagon.
Yeah, I did. So that day, it was a beautiful September day. We all know that.
Yeah.
And I was working in there. I had my schedule unexpectedly free up. So I went to the gym, went out for a run.
Well, how often does that happen?
Almost never. you start work there at 6, you leave at about 7 at night.
Wow.
It's a long day. Most of the day is filled with meetings. So it was really unusual. So I just took the opportunity to go.
Hit the gym.
And hit the gym and go out for a nice run. And while I was running, of course, I was oblivious to the news.
Yeah.
But as I came back into the gym and was changing clothes, showered, changed clothes, I could hear over the PA system the story of the news about that planes crashing into the two towers, the twin towers. So I just hurried up and wanted to get back to my office, turn the TV on and see what was going on. The gym is kind of outside of the Pentagon and over a pedestrian bridge and underground. So I came up out of the stairwell at the top of that bridge right as the airplane impacted the Pentagon on the other side.
Oh, man.
So I could see that very first plume of smoke go up, and there were just two of us standing there kind of watching with slack-jawed.
Yeah.
And not really knowing what it was and not really tying it yet to the attacks in New York City.
Wow. And so you had no idea what was going on, really.
None. But moments later, you know, there's about 16 or 20 doors there to the Pentagon on that side of the building, and they just
flew
open. Popped open, and there was
a
mass of humanity running away.
And you were really walking toward the building.
Yes.
Yeah, that's – and then what'd you do? What do you do when everyone else is exiting?
Well, there was no way I could have swum up that stream. So we just – most of us went and congregated down by the river, the Potomac River, on the north side of the building. And we're trying to figure out what was happening. I think one of the most patriotic things that I remember that day is an F-16 from Andrews Air Force Base came screaming overhead really low.
Yeah.
And obviously it had got scrambled, but a little bit too late to
– Yeah.
to stop the airplane. But
and
it was,
just circled, didn't it?
Yeah, just circled low and loud, and it was very impressive. And we knew at that point that the events were tied together.
Yeah. I mean, remember, that was such a tense situation because they thought another plane was on its way to the White House.
Yeah, and a lot of us were just, you know, we didn't know what to do. We were standing down by the river. And remember, there's tens of thousands of people working this building.
Right.
And so there's a lot of people. And then the Pentagon police, who did an excellent job, were right there with loudspeakers saying, run away, basically, because there's another plane inbound to D.C. We don't know where it's going. And, of course, that was a plane that crashed in Pennsylvania.
Oh, It's just – it's a lot, isn't it? I mean –
It is.
And you knew people. I mean, you knew of – you went to work with these people. You'd go to meetings and sit in meetings with these people. You didn't happen to lose anyone in your group.
No.
But you knew others that had lost a lot.
Yeah, most of the people that worked for me actually worked in an office building about 3 miles away in Roslyn. So,
oh, thank heavens.
But they were all in and out of the Pentagon regularly to meetings, so I had to go count noses and see if we could find everybody, which was a real challenge. But I did have a neighbor who lost an Army colonel that had lost about 30 people right at the point of impact.
Really?
And to walk through the recovery and how do you put your office back together afterwards with him was kind of an incredible experience.
This has got to be you've done a lot. You're a wing commander, a group commander, a squadron commander. Was this, I guess, one of your biggest lessons that you had through the military?
Well, it brings what you do for a living real close to
time,
home.
Right?
Because any of us can go to work on any given day or out to run errands on any given day, and you might not come home.
But to be attacked
on our own territory
and in the military,
or something we would have never have expected
in our country, isn't that just it's amazing? As I sit there and I think, I just think of I wouldn't go back to work. I would have just – I'd be gone – and I didn't go back to work actually when I got back. But you tell a really interesting story. So you – when did – that day you had to leave because they wouldn't let you back in the building.
Right.
And then what? You go home.
Yeah, my car was stuck in the parking lot on the south side where the plane impacted. And so I finally got home late in the evening. But the next day, the key staff, the key personnel in the Pentagon had to be back in the office. And I normally got in about 6. And
you were back
to
work
early.
At 6 a.m.
Absolutely. And it was just kind of a skeleton staff. But it was important for the military to project to the world that we weren't going to stop working.
We're back
just
at
because
it.
Of this attack.
Oh, wow. That is – I mean, I guess that's the lesson, right, is that we're not going to be stopped.
Right.
It's just we're going to keep going.
And the people in the military are trained to deal with stress, of course,
and
to do the right things. And you just roll up your sleeves and go to work. The very next day I was assigned down to the Air Force Operations Center to run a shift, a 12-hour shift. And it was every day for about 3 months.
For 3 months you were?
Well, we were spinning up into a war footing, activating the reserve forces.
Oh, I didn't even think of that. Yeah, you had to get ready for war.
Yeah, putting together the strategies on who and where to attack. And so we didn't have a lot of time to think about and ponder what had happened.
Yeah.
We were working, 12-hour days and going home and late and going to bed and starting it all over the
next
day.
Did you feel like did you know you were making history? Did you know how big this was the minute?
I don't think so.
Yeah, I mean, because it seemed – and then it got bigger and bigger, right?
I mean, just hearing the term Patriots Day, seeing the celebrations, the museums, the healing fields, all of the things that – the flags out in front of all the houses today – it has really grown into something that's evolving into a
– It's something super powerful. Maybe what we ought to do – let's have Joni come over for a sec. We only have about a minute now, Joni, but we'll get you back. But Joni, so here you are. You're at home and what happened? You get the call.
I was actually teaching a middle school class of math.
Were you really?
And a friend of mine came in to my classroom and said, "I'm going to watch your class. You need to go to the library."
Oh, no.
And so
she knew Ken worked at the Pentagon.
She knew what was going on. And so I got into the library and I looked at the TV on. I looked at it and I just was stopped in my steps. I couldn't believe what I was seeing. And the thought came to me, I don't know where Ken works in this building. I don't know what view we're seeing of this building.
No.
And I don't know where he is or what's happened to him. And it was
– empty.
It was really hard.
How long were you left not knowing?
Was he a good man that eventually called you? Well, the cell phone lines were
– You couldn't get out.
We couldn't get through. I immediately went outside and tried to call and I couldn't. And the principal let me go home. And I spent – a good hour or two.
Had to be, because I was
before we could get a hold of him. And it was a great relief to hear his voice.
Yeah, yeah.
But then the
who
do I know there, and how do I get a hold of our children who don't know what's happened to their dad? We had a son in Spain. We had a son at the University of Utah. We had a son or a daughter in the MTC in Provo, yeah. And we had two kids in the high school. So
wow,
it was rough.
you know what? And again, we'll come back and talk more. But really, thank you for going through that, really, for the country, for all of us.
That's hard.
It was way hard. We're talking again with Kenneth and Joni Page. Kenneth, it was in the Pentagon on 9/11, and Joni was in school and then had to track Ken down, teach him a lesson. See the pain we put each other through, but that's, I guess, there's the benefit of love, right? If you love each other, then you get the benefit of fretting. Okay, we're taking a break, folks. Honoring those. And again, I want to so honor all of those in the military that give their lives day in, day out, risk their lives, and just show us and model for us patriotism. Also, everybody that had lost a loved one, we honor you as well. We're going to take a break. We're coming right back. This is the Matt Townsend Show, celebrating, honoring, revering those that we lost on 9/11. Townsend Show, remembering and honoring those that we lost on 9/11 and the heroes that were made that day and the heroes that are in every story of everybody that exercised some faith, that exercised some, I don't know, belief and power. We're talking with Kenneth Page and his wife, Joni. Kenneth was in the Pentagon. He was working there as a defense contractor. Is that right?
Or
were you,
colonel.
You were a colonel when
duty,
you were
yeah.
there.
Uh-huh.
You were active duty colonel. And by a blessing from above, your calendar clears, you decide to go exercise, and then the plane hits the building.
Yeah.
And you weren't in meetings. You weren't over there doing busy work. You could have been hurt.
Absolutely. It was the only time in my entire tour at the Pentagon that I went to the gym at that time of day.
See,
literally.
By the way, Ken, that's why I don't go to the gym.
Yeah. I understand. You never know what's going to happen.
You never know. But now I'm going to start going. But Joni was his wife, by the way, of 37 years. Congratulations on that.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Which, by the way, after this, she probably wasn't, you know, she may have been mad at you. Because you couldn't get a hold of him forever.
No, it wasn't his fault. I wasn't mad at
you
him.
Understood.
But I was pretty concerned.
But that's what I want to talk about, because that morning you had a prompting. You had something come over you. Talk about that.
I was getting ready to go to school, and while I was doing my hair, I total impression. A demand.
Yeah, a command,
A command to pray for the safety of my husband.
Just came to your mind.
Just came into my mind. And so I did, and not knowing why, but I did it anyway and went off to school thinking, what a beautiful day. And then it occurred to me after I saw the pictures on the TV why I
isn't
had been
amazing?
Told to do that.
And it's so subtle, isn't it? Because you'd... But I mean, yeah, pray for the safety of your husband. And that maybe was what cleared your schedule.
That's what I'm thinking.
Something cleared your schedule. Or maybe that's what got you to go to the gym.
Yeah.
God intervened to get you to the gym.
I think so, because it was so unusual. You know, the days are long there. They're 12, 13-hour days, and they're mostly filled with meetings. And they just don't get canceled. It just doesn't happen. So it was a very unusual experience from start to finish.
Well, and how powerful to know. It's interesting, when you finally made it home, Joni was talking about how you just kind of fell into each other's arms. And
yeah, it was
relief.
it was, yeah, we had to really express some emotion at that time just to actually see him and have him in my arms and know he really was safe.
Oh. Yeah, and I think Joni had to think about that all day. You know, I ended up having to walk the 3 miles over to where my people were working in that office building, which took about an hour, and then try and track those people down and find them. So I was busy nonstop, and really didn't have a chance to actually sit down and process what happened until I got home.
But one thing that's interesting about you, you were you a squadron commander? What were you doing in the Pentagon? What was your role?
I wasn't a commander there, but I was the deputy director of command and control. So I was working with the AWACS airplanes, mm-hmm. the direct fighter jets.
Yeah.
When you're in operations, we'd do the organized, train, and equip. That's what the Pentagon does.
Getting everybody
ready to go and funded and all that mm-hmm. stuff. So that's what I was doing for a job.
Well, which is interesting because it's a leadership type of role.
Yeah.
And then meanwhile, and a lot of people don't know this, but in the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, it's no one really in the church leadership is paid. So you just kind of are – you just are given opportunities to serve. You happen to be what they call a stake leader, a stake president, which is over probably 2,000-3,000 members of the church.
Yeah, 4,500.
You need to know the number exactly.
Yeah, and 12 congregations.
12 congregations and about 4,500 LDS faithful were under your stewardship. Meanwhile, you're trying to be a leader in the Pentagon, having to worry about all of your people mm-hmm. in a building many miles away, and worry about 4,500 people, and worry about your wife. And so how do you do that? Where do you begin?
You just do it.
Yeah.
Every spare moment, you're thinking of doing something. So if you have a down minute on the job, you know, I make a few phone calls and get people working on it. Within the geographical boundaries of this organization, this church organization, we had 5 military installations. And the Pentagon wasn't within my geographical boundaries, but I still had quite a few people that I was responsible for that mm-hmm. worked at the Pentagon. So trying to figure out who might have been hurt, killed, injured.
I mean, you're now worried, do I have members of my congregations that have passed away? So I got to go see them. I want to go see them. And meanwhile, you finally got home, Joni, and then all of a sudden your ward members, your church congregation started gathering around you.
Yes, the doorbell was ringing and people were coming in. They were helping me make phone calls to our parents and to our children who were away from us to let them know that their dad was okay.
And so powerful.
Yeah, it was great.
Talk about your lessons. What lessons have you taken away from being there?
I think just the thought that you can go to work on any given day and not come home. So it's wise to have your life in order.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Make sure you tell your spouse on the way out the door that you love her.
You love her.
Give them a kiss. Make sure you have a good relationship with your children. You just don't know what's going to happen because it's out of your control. So I think that was a big lesson.
What does it feel like? Do you remember the spirit of unity that the country felt? What did it feel like being somebody so deeply in the military, in the leadership that you were preparing for the war, to have the country behind you?
Oh, it was fabulous. That's probably the biggest thing I remember about it, is one of the few times our country has been unified.
Don't you think?
And
totally.
Galvanized is, mm-hmm. is kind of the word that comes to my mind.
Yeah.
In how we were feeling. Clergy, we had broadcasters, we had politicians giving voice to how we were feeling, our thoughts and our feelings and our emotions during the day. But the whole country was locked together in lockstep in moving forward.
Isn't that amazing? And don't you remember? I remember like a serviceman would walk down the aisle of an airplane and everyone would just cheer. I mean, it's like, wow, when have we ever – I mean, you know, Vietnam kind of took that away from everyone.
We did not do that before 9/11.
I know.
And that's been one of the best things.
And then we kind of got a bad taste again recently. I mean, it's like, come on. We don't need disasters to recognize how great we've got it. It's powerful.
It is very powerful.
Talk to us, Joni, as we wrap up. What did you learn? What do you take away? You're not just a teacher. You're not just a mom. You're not just a wife. You saw some really powerful blessings.
I I took away that you never take anything for granted. And a lot like Ken, just the relationships that you have are the most important things that we have, and our belief and our faith. And as awful as it was, those things were strengthened. And so, you know, you can look back on an event and say, we were truly blessed. And, you know, you understand the power of prayer. You understand the power of unity. You understand the power of family better.
Yeah.
Because of having gone through that.
Isn't it amazing? And there's this symbol, it seems like, of the Pentagon that you, even though only you were on the other side of the Pentagon and the side that got hit, but the next morning when you go in, there's soot, ashes, whatever, from the explosion that had made its way through the ventilation systems, and you're cleaning up your side. I mean, that's kind of like symbolic of this world. You can't take a hit on one part of the world without it impacting you.
Yeah, it was pretty somber. I was literally the only person in the office.
Were you?
And,
the essential member had to go.
And there was nothing really to do at that time,
right,
except clean up, because we were still, the senior leaders were still trying to figure out how to move forward.
What we're doing next.
Yeah.
Well, I appreciate you guys. I really do. And again, everybody in the military, you saw a lot. I mean, as a wing commander here at Hill Air Force, that's a big deal. You've served in a lot of big roles. And yet it's also interesting that you still had to deal with your people one-on-one.
Yeah.
You know, you can be the greatest leader in the world, but you still got to greet them one-on-one.
Yeah. And that's the key to leadership, I think. It's a one-on-one relationship with everybody.
Well, and it's also powerful to see your marriage because, again, that was – one-on-one.
Yeah, it really helped us to appreciate each other more and to really be more aware of each other's needs and be in tune to help each other.
Yeah. Well, you're beautiful. Keep it up.
Thanks.
I hope you guys have another 37 years.
So do we.
Yeah, we're working on it.
Wouldn't that be great? You've got it. Hey, what we're going to do is this. We're going to take a break. And we're going to end the celebration. I mean, we're going to end the commemoration and the honoring of those on 9/11 with, you know, God Bless America by Kate Smith. Then when we come back, we're going to do a little preparation for the BYU football game. Kate Smith, folks, God Bless America. Welcome back, everybody, to the Matt Townsend Show, and welcome to the pregame show. We like to do a pregame show. BYU Cougars will be playing Houston at 7 o'clock tonight.
7 o'clock.
I have a feeling it's going to be
crazy.
Are you
hooked on that feeling?
Please don't sing.
Okay.
But here's the deal.
Ooh, gotcha.
Because how often do we get to set up a pregame show?
We don't that often.
That's right.
Because
9/11
usually
is the only day.
Yeah. Usually they're on Saturdays in the afternoon.
But
we've got football coming up in about 10 minutes.
Now, we tried to go, you know, to the tailgating parties in search of food.
Well, that's what you were searching for.
Yes. But apparently they're all gone to go watch.
They're actually down at the stadium now. Things are happening at the stadium as we speak.
Well, if only we had somebody on location who could help us to understand what's going on. I think we do.
Do we?
We do. The queen.
We sent the redhead.
The queen of the show. We all, a.k.a. Ginger Snap. Maddie Richard.
Hey,
is
guys.
How are you, Maddie?
It's great. It's crazy down here. It's so fun.
Is there food?
You guys are missing out. Is there food? You walk out of our broadcast building and you can smell barbecue. I am not kidding. the sky. I like thought there was a fire by the stadium. Nope, it's just some people grilling over ribs.
Making some ribs.
Awesome.
Have you? Are you there by yourself?
No, I am part of the probably 500 people that are already here.
Wow.
To watch the Cougar Walk, and that's just the people I can see. The line is—it's like a sea of blue that starts at the south stand, and just goes around the stadium. I don't even know how far back. I'm not at the end of the line. No way am I going to the back.
Well, this is weird because you're not very tall. How can you see so far?
I can't. I'm telling you. That's why I don't know how many people are here because it's just crazy.
You know,
so many people, and I can't see the end because I'm a shorty.
No, but you're also you're giving us the play by play. Talk about the stadium because a few things are going to be different about the game. Some of the helmets are going to be changing. The uniforms will be changing.
Yeah. So both teams have done a tribute to 9/11. BYU has helmets that have an American flag, and they have just this beautiful tribute to 9/11 on the helmets. I think Houston also has helmets that are this tribute. And then in the stadium right now, nobody's sitting down, and the seats fell out. We will not forget.
Oh, really? So there's going to be one of those, hey, flip your card up.
Yep.
And it'll spell out the words, we will not forget.
Yeah, it's really
we will
really
never
cool.
forget.
We will never forget, exactly. And I'm told that they're going to be doing a very beautiful tribute of the national anthem at the beginning. And Brad and Haley Devine are videographers that are well-known across Utah. They're going to be filming that, actually.
Wow.
That beautiful,
tribute.
Tribute with the national anthem. It's going to be an awesome game. And all the people here have so much energy. They're so excited. It's the first game. It's a great time to be patriotic and be proud of your team. It's just going to be a really great day today.
That's awesome. Sean.
Yeah, now they've also redone the logo in the middle of the field to look like the logo that is on the helmets for BYU.
Yeah.
They're doing everything up.
They are.
They're pulling out all the stops. And Cosmo can't talk, Matt, but he wanted me to tell you to give you a high five. And I'm going to give you a high five right when I get back to the studio, right from Cosmo.
Well, by the way, a high five would be great, but bring some ribs.
I'm gonna stop by. There's a dozen tailgaters, and some of them have been here since like noon.
Tell them I'll help their marriages.
Okay. I will exchange ribs for therapy. Does that sound good?
Yeah, yeah. Hey, this is what I want you to do, though, because Cosmo told you something. So I want you in your best voice to imitate Cosmo's voice.
No. Cosmo doesn't talk. He gestures, Matt. Come on.
So he gestured to give me a high five?
Yeah.
He pointed to my phone. Who are you on the phone with? And I said, oh, Matt Townsend. And he goes, high five. And then pointing to my phone, so high five for you.
Gosh.
That is what I'm going to do.
Is Cosmo married?
I'm going to say, was Cosmo in the office recently?
Yeah. Maybe Cosmo was picking up on you.
Oh.
Oh, well, he did sweep me off my feet one time for a picture.
Did he really?
He did. And it was on my bucket list to get a picture of Cosmo before I left BYU. And I've got one where he's just swept me off my feet.
Did you kiss him?
Oh, no. Not on the first date, Matt.
No.
You teach better than that.
Well, there was that one time you came in and you had all that fur on your lip.
No. Oh, well, you know what? Let's not talk about that.
Okay.
We're supposed to be talking about football.
So, about 500 people there. What? Okay.
At least. I
want you to give me your pick on the game. Who are you going to go with?
Oh, BYU, of course.
No. What do you, this is, I'm going to test you.
Uh-oh.
Because I really don't remember their mascot, but Houston's got to have a mascot.
It's the Astros, right?
I think that's their baseball team. Do you know who the Houston mascot is?
Oh goodness, I want to say that they're Aggies too.
Ooh, are they?
Like you got to say, I think they might be, but I'm not sure. I'm not well versed on Houston stuff.
Okay.
Only well versed on BYU stuff.
Yeah. Well, yeah. You've kissed BYU's.
I know, right? I know. So I can't be known anything about just these other teams.
Well, let me just tell you what we've found out via the interweb.
The interweb. What does it tell us?
The mascot is the University of Houston Shasta.
The Shasta?
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know what a Shasta is, except it's a beverage.
So do they have a big beverage come out and dance
yeah.
to their hats?
It's a carbonated
cool.
beverage.
Oh, I know what it is. They're cougars.
Are they? Is this cougar against cougar?
I believe
so. This is cougar against cougar. They're both cougars.
Also known as the mountain lion.
Are you ready for this, Matt?
Yes.
2-year-olds and 30-year-olds.
Yeah, we got some fans here that are ready.
Really?
Yeah, it's cougar against cougar.
Cougar.
Just told me.
Yes, cougar against cougar, but I think their cougar's name is Shasta.
Yeah, mm-hmm. The cougar, maybe it's a girl cougar.
Oh, ooh, therapy.
Cosmo and Shasta, I don't know what's going to happen.
Keep your eye on Cosmo. You may have just lost
I'm
your cougar.
I'm not going to let him out of my sight.
Hey, are there very many Houston fans there?
I've only seen a couple. I can seriously tell you, I've been walking. I walked over here from the building, and it is blue and white. Everybody walking over is wearing blue and white. And everybody that's standing in line, except for a couple, blue and white. It's just a sea. It's awesome to see such an incredible, Cougar Pride right now.
Cougar
Everyone's
Pride.
Just sporting the colors. They're all decked out, ready to go for it. There's flags everywhere. People have face paint. And the band has just started playing. Oh, my goodness. The band just started playing.
There we go.
This is getting real, guys.
It's crazy.
It's cougar time.
Maddie Richard, appreciate your play-by-play.
Oh, yeah, of course. Getting paid, you're paying me to go hang out at the game.
Actually, I'm paying you to bring me some ribs.
Oh, well, I will see what I can do for you.
Bring me some ribs. Go give Shasta a hug. And a tranquilizer dart.
Perfect.
We appreciate you, Maddie. You're the best. Take care and be careful walking through those tailgaters. Keep your eyes on them. Folks, that's the show. Again, coming up in just a minute or two, the big pregame party and the pregame show getting ready for the University of Houston BYU Cougars football game. Before we go, a little quote from Maya Angelou. We may encounter defeats, but we must not be defeated. That is in memory of 9/11. A little defeat there, but we will not be defeated. And we're not going to be defeated by lifting everybody else up. Tomorrow, folks, we'll be back again on the air. It'll be a best of program, some of our best shows from this week. Again, we'll be back Monday with more ideas, more tools to give you a leg up in this crazy thing called life. Take care and have fun at the game.